We adore you, Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. It's Palm Sunday, and this is our second segment of our teachings today. We, once again, focusing on Jesus entering the city of Jerusalem, and is recognized as the King and Savior. And people singing and shouting, Hosanna to the highest, Hosanna to the King. He's riding on a little horse, yeah? Less than 4 years, that's a horse colt, as they refer to it. The question is, that is not the standard by which a king would, you know, ride. But he goes by that little horse, and they recognized him. Challenge is, do we still recognize him today as the King and Savior? He's on the cross. That's his new ride, yeah? Do you recognize Jesus as the Lord and Savior on that cross? Or it doesn't matter? Or we're still thinking about it? In that humility, as this letter to the Philippians will remind us, he became our greatness, our life, our salvation. Paul will tell us that in his humility, he, you know, won the victory, and at his name every knee bows. God raised him and gave him the name which is above all other names. And at his name, every knee and every tongue confesses that he is the Lord. I know a few other people in scriptures who humbled themselves and God raised them and made them great. Immediately, I remember Mary, who humbled herself, allowed God's will to take her place, just as Jesus did. Lord, it's not my will. Father, it's your will. Mary does the same. Let it be done to me according to your will. Abraham decides the same way. Lord, where should I go? To the land I will show you. He even gives up his own life, livelihood, his own country, and goes to the unknown. It's that kind of thing that he requires from us, that we put aside our will and allow his will to lead and guide us. I would say that's his definition of humility. And I think Saul, who later became Paul, learned the same way. And perhaps that's why we still speak about him as a great guy today. Because he put aside his will and is like, Lord, it's your will. He recognized the King and Lord. Two things I think need to come to our attention. That to be humble, to recognize him as Lord and Savior, we need to listen to him, to obey him, to carry out the mission he sends us to. That's the service we do. And then, of course, there will be suffering and tests that will come, but then to crown us. And that's the secret to greatness. And that's the evidence that we acknowledge him as Lord and Savior. Do you recognize him today? From this gospel narrative of the Passion, as written by St. Luke, a few more lessons we can learn. One, it begins saying that when the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles and the disciples. And that's what? He makes the Eucharist. Bread and wine, he gets and says, this is my body. And the wine, this is the cup. Cup is the new covenant in my blood. What a joy for those who receive the Holy Eucharist. That he says, this is my body. And this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. So every time we receive him in the Eucharist, we partake of himself and we tap into the new covenant made in his blood. What an honor, what a love, what a joy. But of course, as St. Paul would go on to remind us, that we should ensure that we receive him worthily, not anyhowly,
And that's one way we honor him and acknowledge him in the same way. And on the same table Jesus makes the Eucharist, his betrayer is also there. What a shock. That's the very first Mass that was ever celebrated. The betrayer was there, Judas Iscariot. And how many betrayers attend Masses daily, all often as we do? And Jesus says, alas for that man by whom he's betrayed. That's to say, we don't need to worry about the betrayers. Their fate is already sealed unless they repent. He says, alas for that guy. It's destined that you will betray me, but alas for you, man. I think that's not good news when he's speaking Jesus. Jesus speaks it out. So only, we got to only strive to be a true friend of Jesus. Don't struggle to criminalize the betrayers. He knows them. You only call to be his friend, to be his a true worshiper, not his security guard. We are called to be missionaries, not military persona for Christ. And that way, we help others to come to encounter and recognize him. Service is our badge as Christians. What service are you rendering to the kingdom? And our service is to be done in love. We are called to be with him. He says, I'm among you as one who serves. Are you serving any good cause? He's standing with Christ faithfully in his trials. He confesses upon us the kingdom. He confers upon us the kingdom. And where do we find Christ? Jesus is standing with them, among them. Remember that song, whatsoever you do, the least of my brothers, when I was hungry, when I was thirsty, when I was... So he's among those. Are you standing with the poor, with the naked, with the hungry, with the needy, with those who are mourning? Or you've neglected them? The fifth lesson from this wonderful script of this passion of Jesus according to St. Luke. We see, he says, see, Simon, Satan, you must know, as God his wish to sift you all like wheat, but I've prayed for you. When you repent, console, strengthen your brothers. You sometimes feel overwhelmed by your own trials, temptations, and weaknesses. The good news is that Jesus is praying for you. Don't give up on yourself because you are failing many times. Run to him, confess and confess until you get better. He's still waiting for you. He prays for Peter. Perhaps that's why Peter managed to repent, even when he had committed a grave sin. You too have the duty to strengthen your brothers and sisters. And we also keep praying for our Pope, that amidst so many shocks and waves and troubles and temptations and that may come in his office, that may be able to lead Christ's flock. Peter made a great confession that, Lord, whatever it takes, I'll never ever give up on you. And Jesus is like, Peter, by the time the cock crows three times today, you have denied me three times. Yeah? Jesus knew about it. When we begin to, we begin to decline when we think that we have made it rock solid, that we can't fall anymore, then we should be ready to fall. Because we lower our guard by that kind of mindset, and we set ourselves up for a big fall. Peter and Judas, all are sinners. But Peter repented, Judas condemned himself. Which kind of sinner are you? Which kind of sinner am I? One who repents or one who keeps condemning myself? That even some people, even after they received confession, still they condemn themselves. Peter, in this, I love Jesus' prayer. Father, if you're willing, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, let your will be done, not mine. Let your will be done, not mine. How do we handle circumstances where we are beaten, we are overpowered, where we feel the pain is too much? How do we handle that? When we feel God is silent, what do we do? You don't hear anywhere Jesus, the Father answering Jesus in this situation. Dad is silent. Jesus does something. One, he recognizes the Father's will. Let your will be done, not mine. How many times Do we push Jesus, push the Lord to get our will done? In the circumstances, it was only God's will that would make things happen. Not Jesus, not the Son's will, but the Father's will.
That's why we need to remain in constant touch with the Father. And then he surrenders to him.
And this is how we ought to talk to God. Don't speak to God like you lent him something. Speak to him with all humility. It's what he refers to. Jesus submitted to death in all humility. And then the Father was like, okay, you got it all now. Even my kingdom, you rule on my in my name. That's where the Lord wants us to get. The Lord does not want us to submit to him in order to oppress us. He wants us to submit to his will such that he can empower us, give us the power and authority over principalities. The people who have learned to do that, and even the devil is afraid of them, that they just speak things and happen,
simply because they allowed the Lord to take over their lives.
And just because a mission comes from God doesn't mean that you won't sweat blood. Jesus sweated blood even when the mission was of God, by God, in God, through God. So, even the Son of God sweated blood. Our joy should only come from knowing that the one who asked me to do it knows the value and will take me through it. That should always be the kind of the comfort, the consolation, especially in the midst of pain, trials, hardships. You know, sometimes we think that when we're doing God's will, all shall be well, besides we have God on our side. But it shows us that even when his Son was doing the Father's will, he sweated blood. So don't be afraid when you're sweating blood, when you feel so hard. Just what about one thing? Is it the Lord's will or not? That's what matters. It is surprising that the apostles, Jesus is there busy sweating blood, the apostles are busy sleeping. What a joke! But Jesus understands their pain. They have pain, sorrow, doubt, fear, anguish has overwhelmed them. And they feel like they cannot go on. Do you sometimes feel like that? You feel like, Lord, I want to pray, but I cannot. I feel so exhausted. I feel so tired. I feel so disappointed. Jesus has a good news for you today. He says, get up and pray, not to be put to the test. Before the devil puts you down completely, he will take away your power to pray, your ability to seek the divine, to connect with the master. And then he'll be able to put you down solidly and completely. You cannot sleep at the war front, my dear. Otherwise, you lose the opportunity for instruction, connection, and taking on the enemy. So we pray for that grace as we enter into this holy week. That, Lord, let me surrender to you. Let me not give up. Let me keep awake. Let me rise up and be able to do and seek your will at all times. Let me not forsake you. Let me not betray you. And may the blessing of the mighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen. Shalom.